Chapter 43, In Conversation. The Ministry of Regeneration maintained its air of festivity, although the governor had left to join his most intimate circle. Many were talking about the event. Hundreds of fellow spirits were volunteering for the arduous work of defense in response to the appeal of our great spiritual leader. I found Tobias in order to consult with him about the possibility of volunteering. But the benevolent brother smiled at my innocence and said, "Andre, you have just begun a new job. Don't be in such a hurry to ask for more responsibility. There will be work for all, as the governor has just told us. Don't forget that our chambers of rectification comprise centers of day and night active effort. Don't worry. Remember that 30,000 workers will be called for permanent vigilance. Thus, there will be large gaps to fill in the rear guard." Noticing my disappointment, my kind companion added good-humoredly, after a short pause, "Content yourself with your enrollment in the School Against Fear. You can be sure that it will do you a lot of good." Just then I received a big hug from Lysias, who had taken part in the celebration as part of the delegation from the Ministry of Assistance. With Tobias's leave, I walked with Lysias in order to have a more private conversation. "Have you met Minister Benvenuto in Regeneration, the one who arrived the day before yesterday from Poland?" he asked. "I haven't had the pleasure." "Let's go meet him," Lysias replied, enveloping me in the vibrations of his great brotherly love. "For a long time I have had the great honor of including him in the circle of my personal acquaintances." After a few moments we were in the large green hall that had been dedicated to the work of the Minister of Regeneration, whom I knew only by sight. Several groups of visitors were exchanging ideas under the cover of large trees. Lysias led me to the largest group, where Benvenuto was exchanging impressions with several friends. Lysias graciously introduced me, and the minister welcomed me, kindly admitting me into his circle. The conversation continued its natural course, and I noticed that the situation on the earthly sphere was being discussed. "The picture we're seeing now is so painful," commented Benvenuto in a grave tone. "Accustomed to the service of peace in the Americas, none of us could imagine what the spiritual aid work was going to be like on the fields of Poland. All is darkness and difficulty down there. One cannot expect sparks of faith in the aggressors, nor in most of the victims, for that matter, because they have given themselves entirely up to frightful impressions. The incarnates don't help us. They only consume our strength. I have never seen such great collective suffering since I began my ministry." "Did the delegation stay there for a long time?" someone asked with interest. "We remained there for all the time available to us," replied the minister. "The head of the expedition, our colleague from assistance, thought it wise that we focus exclusively on the task so that we could enrich ourselves by observing the situation and by taking better advantage of the experience. In fact, the conditions couldn't have been better. I found that our own capabilities were far from the extraordinary capacity for endurance possessed by the self-denying spirit workers on duty there. They were effectively performing all the assisting tasks in spite of the suffocating atmosphere, which was saturated with destructive vibrations. The battlefield that is invisible to our earthly kin is a real hell of indescribable proportions. Never does the human spirit show its condition as a fallen soul as thoroughly as it does in war. It displays remarkably diabolical features. I saw intelligent and cultured men precisely localize certain sectors of peace activity as targets for what they called direct hits. Bombs of high explosive power destroyed buildings that had been patiently built. The poisonous fluids of the machine guns, together with the pestilent emanations of hatred, made any help almost impossible. However, what distressed us most was the sad condition of some of the military aggressors when they left their physical bodies due to their wounds. Most of them came under the control of dark forces and ran from the missionary spirits, calling them all ghosts of the cross. But weren't they rescued so that they could learn the truth? Someone asked, interrupting. Benvenuto mouthed a meaningful gesture and answered, "It is always possible to attend peaceful lunatics in their home. But what remedy can we use for the furiously insane except to place them in an asylum? There was nothing to be done with such creatures except to leave them to the abyss of darkness, where they will naturally be compelled to readjust themselves and to have worthy thoughts. It is proper for assistance missions to rescue only those who are willing to receive help from above. So the scenes we witnessed there were very heartrending for many reasons." Availing himself of a short pause, another remarked, "It is almost unbelievable that Europe, with so many cultural treasures, is suffering such a calamity." "Lack of religious preparation, my friends," remarked Benvenuto in a firm tone voice. "An educated intelligence is not enough for humankind. It is necessary to enlighten their thoughts about the eternal life. Churches are always holy in their fundamentals, and their pastorate will always be divine when they preach the truth of God. But a political pastorate will never quench the spiritual thirst of civilization. Without the divine breath, religious personalities may inspire respect and admiration, but neither faith nor trust." "But what about Spiritism?" one of the others asked abruptly. "Didn't its first doctrinal manifestations surface in the Americas and Europe over 50 years ago? Hasn't that new movement continued to spread the eternal truths?" Benvenuto smiled, mouthed an extremely meaningful gesture, and added, "Spiritism is our great hope, and in every respect, it is the consoler of incarnate humankind. But its progress is still very slow. It is a sublime gift which most people do not yet have the eyes to see. An overwhelming percentage of new adherents approach this divine resource still under the copy of old religious vices. They want to reap its benefits, but are unwilling to give anything of themselves. They invoke its truth, but don't go in search of it. While many scholars reduce mediums to mere human guinea pigs, many believers act like certain patients who, though healed, believe more in sickness than in health, and never come to stand on their own two feet. Generally down there, they are looking for materialized spirits to perform transitory phenomena, whereas here we are spending our time looking for spiritualized human beings to perform serious labor." The play on words aroused expressions of good humor in everyone, but the minister resumed gravely, "Our tasks are really astronomical. We cannot forget that every person is a seed of divinity. Let us attack our duties with hope and optimism, and always be convinced that if we do our share, we may rest in peace, for the Lord will do the rest."